morning and happy Sabbath. All right, I have a question for you guys. How many of you have been hungry that you think that you would eat just about anything? Any of you guys? All right. Well, I'm going to tell you a story about a little boy named Alan. And he was pretty hungry because his mom didn't have very much money. And so he didn't get to eat three meals a day like we do. So he was walking through the park one day, and all he could think about was his belly kept on growling and growling because he was so hungry. And he saw a little silver package, and it looked like it was saran wrap around it. And he's like, oh, I bet that's a sandwich, because all he could think about was food. So he ran over there, and if it was a sandwich, he was going to eat it. He didn't care whose it was. So he walked over there and opened it, and guess what it was? It wasn't a sandwich. It was a whole bunch of money. He's like, oh, he's like, I bet I could buy lots of food with this. He's like, well, it's like, my mom always told me if I found something that wasn't mine, I was to bring it to the police station so they could give it back to the owner. So he sat there and he's like, what should I do? What would you have done, B?
I would have either looked for the owner around the park or I would have taken it for myself.
Yeah, that's what most kids would have done. So, well, he decided to do the honest thing, and he took it back to the police station, and he told them that he had found all this money in the park, and he wanted them to find the owner. And the police said, thank you. He's like, not too many kids would have brought this here. They would have went and spent it. And so the policeman told him that if the owner didn't come in a couple weeks, that the money was his. But he told him not to get too hopeful, because usually whenever people lost that much money, then they'd come back looking for it. So a couple weeks went on and about the money that he had found in the park, and Christmas time was coming. And his mom, she had to pay so many bills and everything. She didn't have any money to buy him any presents or anything, so they weren't going to have a very good Christmas, he thought. And about a week before Christmas, they got a knock on the door, and it was the policeman. And she said, yeah, she's like, is everything okay? And he said, I just want to let you know that you have a very honest boy. She's like, well, I hope so. And he said, he asked Alan if he remembered the money he had found in the park, and he said, yeah. And apparently nobody had came and got the money, so he got to keep the money. And they opened a savings account and bought him some much-needed clothes, and they even got to buy some presents for Christmas. So just remember, if you do the honest thing, it pays off. So you may go back to your seat.
Praise the Lord. Good to have each and every one here today. It's good to be in the fellowship of believers, isn't it? Like believers and in the fellowship with all of heaven. So we're in the fellowship with heaven today, aren't we? We prayed this morning that heaven would come down, right, and glory would fill our souls. And that has to be our prayer this morning, and all of us together, heaven's come down here to be with us. And so expect a blessing because God's given it. How many have received blessings already this morning? I have. Yes. You know, through the Word, through songs that are sung and congregational or individual, we can be blessed. Children's story. There's blessings for us to receive, and so we need to be grabbing a hold of those while we still can. You have your Bible. We're going to be talking about a subject that we began several weeks ago. So some will kind of get maybe in the middle of some things here. But it's going to be good because we're talking about a vessel of honor. A vessel of honor. We decided, if nothing else, the last time that we talked, everyone here said, I want to be a vessel of honor. Did we not? No one's going back on that, I hope, this morning. We came to the conclusion that we either be a vessel of honor or a vessel of dishonor. And the choice is yours to make. And so we're going to talk about, it's going to be like a stair-stepping as we go. How can we obtain? How can we be what God wants us to be? Are there steps to be taken? I find in life, if there's something that's up a little bit high, usually you have to get on steps. You have to get on a ladder. You work at it. I found out that going up is more difficult than coming down. How about you? And it seems like this life is always on the uphill, isn't it? We're always struggling to just maintain. But I believe God's desire for us is a little different than that. I believe He has blessings of all kind He wants to bestow upon us. He wants to make our journey as easy as possible. And thank God He has prepared a way through Jesus Christ that we can have eternal life. But while we are here, I am convinced that He wants us to be a vessel of honor. And how does that take place? And part of this being a vessel of honor, it has to do with influence. Now up front, I ask you a question so you can think on it, meditate a little bit on influence and how important it is. I think we've probably talked about it on several different occasions. But influence is so, so mighty, isn't it? I'm influenced at times when you read the newspaper and you say there was a poll taken. There was a poll taken and 1,000 people were asked this question. 850 said this. Now, if you're, you know, I'm maybe not that easy influenced, but there are people who are. But you know what? That you still think about that, and so you say there must be something to it because the majority says. Every once in a while I hear, oh, what is that program on the radio? And I'm going back, it's, they ask questions to be a millionaire. Who wants to be a millionaire? Anybody ever heard that? Who wants to be? Well, I guess all of us raise our hand to that, would like to be. And when the contestant gets stumped, they'll say, let's ask. Nobody else is with it today. We're going to ask the audience what they think. And you know what? Most generally, the majority, the audience, is correct. If the audience says 80% says this is the answer, most generally it is. So we are, whether we agree or not, we're under the influence of a majority of people, a poll, a public opinion. We listen to these things. I'm influenced by a friend. You're influenced by loved ones. Now, influence is for good or for evil, isn't it? So there is an influence there. And so I looked up the word influence just quickly here this morning. It says, the power or process of producing an effect upon a person. Now, notice what it says. An influence is a power. Now, power moves things. Are we still there? So if you think, well, you know, I have no influence, I have no power. Yeah, your word is influence. Your word, many times, is power, and it will move people into action. And that would be for good or bad. So it is a power. You want to produce an effect upon an individual. Oh, you look nice today. Somebody not with me at all. The only one that thought they looked nice today is the one who looked in the mirror and saw themselves. Isn't that right? Oh, I look nice today. No. Influence. It produced an effect, does it not? Oh, your hair looks different. It looks nice today. Well, there's an influence. It had an effect. Before you know it, you're walking down the hall and you're flipping it just a little bit. We want everybody to see it. Why? Because somebody said, your hair looked nice. Now, the other 99 who said it didn't tell you. Isn't that right? That 9 may say, they're not going to tell you that. It looked nice. It has an influence. You get up feeling pretty good for the day. First person you meet, isn't this a pathetic day? This is a horrible day, worst day of my life. Whew, you know, I was kind of thinking the same thing too. You were not, possibly, until you met that person. You heard all their woes, and all of a sudden you went down too. It had its influence, and it drove you into some kind of action. Good or bad, always. An influence with power. I like to think about influence this morning because I want to talk about, in one of the building blocks, God's influence, a godly influence. And so with this in mind, we have to think in terms of influence then to me would be persuasion. I wonder if there's anyone here today who has been persuaded to do something they really didn't want to do, but the guy you were talking to was persuasive. We've got two and one, we got a half. Like they really didn't, I chose myself, right? Brother Richard, were you ever influenced when you were growing up? Boy, I was. You know, I was influenced a lot. And I think I influenced some. But I felt like if I was influencing somebody, I wanted to influence them into action, not just to agree with me. See that window up there? I believe I can hit it with a rock before you can. Because I'm better. I'm stronger. I can throw it straighter than you can. Oh, yeah? Well, let's see. Now, what have I done to this poor lad? I've got him in trouble. Most generally, I won't throw the rock, but he will. And I can always say it was him that did it. But I influenced him. And when you influence somebody, you are persuasive. And that's the only way you can get them to walk along and accept what you have said, is if you're persuasive. You go into a store and man's selling a vacuum cleaner. And he says, you know, this is a pretty good vacuum cleaner, but you know, I wouldn't have it in my house. Well, he's influenced me. I say, I won't have it in mine either. But the guy that holds that 14-pound bowling ball over his head, he's kind of influencing me a little bit. I think there's little tricks to those things. But you know what? It influenced. Wow, that thing's powerful. Get the point here, friend. Influence is powerful. And every individual has an influence, regardless of your age. No matter when you're real small, when you're young, you have an influence. You influence mom and dad in a lot of ways. When you're older, you influence mom and dad. Mom and dad influence others. So persuasive then means you have some arguments that you put forth, and sometimes they're inducements. See, when I persuade somebody, I said, you know, this is what we ought to do. And if you do this, and if you follow through with this, you know, there's $1,000 at the end of the month for you. That's an inducement. You persuaded them. They're almost persuaded. But when you offer a little something beyond that, you really persuaded them to go ahead. Many times in the workplace, we say, what? Is it incentive? You know, we wouldn't say a bribe. No one uses that term anymore. That went out in the 20s. But, you know, it's an inducement. It's to help them. It's an incentive to get them to produce. Brother, if you drive another 50,000 miles this week, right, we'll buy your lunch. Well, that's not going to work, right? And say, man, forget that. I'm not going to do it. But if they said something, you know, like several thousand dollars at the end of this, a guy might give it a whirl, maybe not that many miles. So we look at these arguments, these inducements, these things that compel us to action. Now let me just give you a couple things before we go into this Bible text to help us understand about persuasion. Chapter 27. You have your Bibles? Let's turn, shall we? Did you bring your sword? Okay, let's stick the old devil, shall we? Let's stick the devil this morning. And usually when you stick the devil, he has to flee. Is that right? Okay, so I don't believe he's here this morning, but if anybody sees him, stick him with a sword, he will flee. He can't stand the truth, isn't that right? Number one. He doesn't want a born-again Christian that loves Jesus, that knows the truth, to try to persuade others. He doesn't want you to really be in love with Jesus. Do you know that? He doesn't want you to give a Bible study. He doesn't want you to give a book out. He doesn't want you to be a good influence, and he's going to do everything he can for our young people at school to be a bad influence, us at work to be a bad influence. Everything he can. The Bible says this in Matthew chapter 27, verse 20. Notice how it's talking about persuasion here. It says, but the chief priest and the elders did what? Now, what did they do? Now, the chief priest, what should they be? What should they be persuading? What should they really be talking about, the chief priest? Would it be the things of the world or should it be the things of God? It should be things of God, isn't that right? But look what the chief priests were doing. Remember, this was when Jesus was before Pilate. Look what the religious leaders were doing. My Bible says the chief priest. Now, is the Bible telling the truth? You better believe it. And the, be careful here. And the elders did what? Persuaded the multitude that they should ask for who? Barabbas, and destroy Jesus. How could you persuade a mob? How could you persuade a multitude of people who supposedly were in their right, supposedly Christians? How could you persuade that group to pick a, wasn't he a murderer? To pick a murderer over the life giver? And many people, no doubt, in that multitude had saw Jesus at work. Don't you believe it? They knew that carpenter. They knew that he was a man that had given his heart, as it were, to God. They knew that he was a man that was different from the rest of the people that was around him. So how could the chief priest and these elders persuade this crowd? Would it have something to do with the crowd's mentality or the crowd's attitude? You get a crowd hungry for blood, somebody not with me, right? And that's all that they're going to want. They're not going to be happy. You get a crowd together that love Jesus and want the blessings to come, and they're going to come, aren't they? But this group already was kind of looking for trouble. And then the chief priest gave, they supposedly gave some evidences. Could you convince people that this murderer over here should be saved and set on the streets to murder again and then kill the life giver? How could they do that? They were persuasive. They had an influence. But notice, this group, my opinion, this group was already set toward that path anyway. If you have a godly mind and Jesus is the center of your mind, someone may try to influence you, but you don't go that way. See, there's a difference. That group was ready. What could these men have said to this group to convince them that Jesus was bad and worthy of the cross and the murderer to be set free? They must have been good at what they were doing. Plus, remember the multitude attitude. They were ready to receive the wrong ideas and thoughts. So we say, okay, they did persuade them. Now notice with me how in Romans chapter 4, quickly, come on, let's do it. I'll get slow sometime, but it's all right. Stay with me. Still in the Word, aren't you? Romans chapter 4, verse 21. Notice what the Bible says again. Romans 4, verse 21. Are we there yet? Okay, talking about faith here in this chapter. But it says here, 4, verse 21. It says here, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to what? To perform. Talking about Abraham here, right? Going into another country. He was going by faith. He was operating by faith here yet. But notice the verse before that said, he, Abraham, staggered not at the promise of whom? Of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Boy, that's an example for us today, is it not? That's such an example for God's people today that we do not stagger at the promises of God. See how often we stagger at the promises of God. God gives all these beautiful, great promises in His Word. You know, He says, for instance, you know, I'll be with you always, even to the end of the world. How many take that serious? He says, I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you. How many of us take that serious? When He said, I know who you are, like there's nobody else on the face of this earth. I know the hair on your head. I know the sparrow that falls out of the tree. I take note of everything that happens to you. The things that make you happy, the things that make you sad. The temptations, the tests, and the trial. And I've made a way for every one of these. Now those are promises. And yet, how many of us forget those promises and we stagger when we get real a little bit? Circumstances, situations of life. But here, the Bible said he didn't stagger. Did you notice that? So that simply meant then he was persuaded, verse 21 says, that what God had promised him, he was what? Able to perform. Now, is that faith or is it not? See, that's all that it takes is for you and I to say, no matter what happens in our life, God is able to perform what He says He can do. Isn't that simple? See, I might make you some promises. That doesn't mean diddly. It should, but you know, that's our humanness. Well, you do this and that. Hey, I'll give you this. I'll do this. That's still human speculation, or that's what we wish, but circumstances maybe prevent. Circumstances does not bother God. Situations do not bother God. He moves those things. So we should never stagger. We have to be persuaded. That means what? Influenced. As we read the Word of God, I'm influenced that God is able to do exactly what He says He will do. How about you this morning? If you're persuaded, you will be a happier person, I guarantee you. You may go through tests. Many of you are going through tests and trials and gallbladder surgery and heart surgery and different ones in here and, you know, different tests. You have to be persuaded that He's able. It will help you. It will give you encouragement. It will give you strength. That the Bible that you have read, there's, and we say this in a good way, there's arguments here that God can back up what He says. There's proof in here that He can do it. He's done it before and He can do it again. Boy, these are, I'm telling you, persuasion. And therefore, it compels me because of these arguments, these persuasions, these, being convinced that He is able to help me. And that's where we have to end up, friend. Listen carefully. This is where we must end up in our walk with Him. When it's all said and done, you and I lay down to rest, as it were, till Jesus comes. We have to be like Paul and say, I'm persuaded. In other words, I'm fully convinced. I know He's able. And that has more to do, dear friend, not with so much the physical and what happens here, but the spiritual. Are you still there with me? The spiritual is what God's interested in today. He said, I'm going to take care of that. I am persuaded that God is able. Friends, that's an awesome thought. You're in the book of Romans. How about a couple chapters over? Let's read some more. This is good for us today to get our cups and our batteries charged to say, my God is able to do what He says. Isn't that what this passage talks about? Romans chapter 8, verses 38 and 39. Romans chapter 8, 38 and 39. Notice how again Paul in his writing, he says, for I am what? I am persuaded that neither, notice this. Say it with me, read it. Death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come. How's it covering? Pretty good so far? Okay, verse 39. Nor height, nor depth, nor any, what, creature shall be able to separate us from what? The love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The man that penned these through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, I'm saying he said when he was shipwrecked, when he was beaten, when they attacked him to kill him, to throw him out, to persecute him, when he didn't have any clothes, when he didn't have any food, the things that he knew was coming his way, the things he was going through right then, the height, the depth, it didn't matter. He knew by example. He knew through his communion with God that he said, nothing can separate me from my God. Isn't that beautiful? And here's a man that went through it. I look at this thing and I'm saying, you know, I'm persuaded that neither death nor life. Do you realize what that means? That even in death, I'm not separate. If I'm righteous and I die in Jesus, I'm not really separated from Him at all. He remembers me. He knows exactly where I'm at. And He longs for the day He can bring me back. So I'm not separated even in death. I'm not separated, you see, in this life. Any kind of power that be in the world cannot separate you. There may be a law that says someday you can't worship on the Sabbath anymore. You can't read this book. You can't do this. You can't say that you love God publicly anymore. My Bible says nothing's going to separate me from the love of God. Isn't that beautiful to know that? See, influence is powerful. There are those, may I just mention here casually here, there are those who think their influence is so good and they go about trying to influence other people. They do it through the internet. They do it through personal letters, you know. And every once in a while, you know, we get one here and other people in ministries get letters all the time. But notice the most generally when people send letters and things around, you know, their aim is always to correct somebody else. You're not doing something right. And so they just really hammer on you. But you know what? None have the courage to put their name on it. They're going to teach you a lesson. They're going to tell you how the hog ate the cabbage. They're going to tell you what you should be doing. And they're sitting home doing nothing but what? Broadcasting things they have no idea about. And so they write things about people and different things which are not true and so on and so forth. In the letter last week, we got down through here, a person was even criticizing and condemning a person that's already dead. Go on. And they said, we hope you like this at the end. What was there to like? I looked in, I said, they're doing the work of the devil. But they make sure they don't sign it. You know, if a man going to say something about somebody else, say, I said it. How about it? Wouldn't that be the right thing? This is what I think. Don't go around being anonymous. The Bible says you have aught against your brother. Go between he and thee alone. Don't try to do it by letter that you send everybody in the country. People do that all the time. That's not right. Influence. Because people who have no idea of what happens, what's going on, they're going to be influenced, are they not? Sure they will. I'll read something. We have time. Inspiration says we should never say anything that would make a bad influence on someone else, ever, about another person's character, ever. In fact, when we read on, and I'll read it later, maybe not this week, but it says, when we do those things, we absolutely blaspheme the name of God. When we attack another person, we're blaspheming his name. Awesome. Powerful. Influence. Romans 14, you're there. Let's just read another one. What? We're there, right? Doesn't take us long. Romans 14, 14. Notice what the Bible said. Once again, talking about some principles here. And I don't want to get into this as a subject, but I want to use the first part here. It's very persuasive to me. Chapter 14 of Romans, verse 14 says, I know and am what? The word again. Persuaded. Now notice this. Here's our key. I'm going to be persuaded by whom? See, this is the one who persuades us, not somebody else who probably doesn't know or who thinks that they know. But we must be persuaded. We must be convinced by the Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't that right? It says that there's nothing unclean of itself. That goes on, we realize that there we're talking about. When it says, I am persuaded, again, that is confident. That means I have assurance. And it's talking about those things that's common to the world, but were forbidden to the Jews. Are you still there? Or the pious Jews. They weren't things that pertained by nature what was unclean. Why? Because God's words already said what is clean and unclean. So God wouldn't contradict that on Scripture. Not go into all that right now, but we need to. Here's our point. He says, I'm persuaded by the Lord Jesus Christ. And friend, that's what I want you today. That's what I want to be. I want to be persuaded that I am in this movement of giving the three angels' message to the world. Probation is about to close. Jesus is coming. And I have to be persuaded that I'm in the right place at the right time. Are you still there? There is a work for us to do right now. I have to be persuaded. I have to be confident that this is the last message to go to the world. I have to have the assurance that this is the right thing to do. Or why do it? Why put yourself out on a limb? Why put yourself in the glass house for people to throw stones and rocks and always find out, you know, what you should do, what you shouldn't do? Why? I have to be convinced that it's right. And when you're convinced that it's right, then you're willing to take a stand for Jesus Christ. And we say, let the chips fall where they may. God's way. Friend, how about today when we think about a godly influence? Let me give you an example before our time is up today. There's several areas in which to cover back in the Old Testament. In Genesis chapter 39, you know this story well, so it's not anything that we're going to spend time on. Other than we're going to get a principle here that we're going to work from. Genesis chapter 39. In verses 2 and 3, we realize here we're talking about Joseph and Potiphar's wife. But notice the principle that we're talking about. If we're wanting to be a vessel of honor, dear friends, first of all, we must, number one, we must exert to the world a godly influence. This is very, very important. Others must see Jesus in you or in me. If they do not, dear friends, they're not going to want what you have, what we think we have. They have to see Jesus, and then they're going to say, they've got something. It's something different than the world has to offer. They're a little bit different, and I want to know what makes them different. And then the questions will come. This is what God wants. He wants you to be different. He doesn't want you to be like the world. But notice the godly influence here. It says, verse 2 and 3, it says, "And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a..." When God is with you, dear friends, you are a prosperous individual. You say, "Well, boy, I'll tell you, the checkbook sure..." That's all we think about. The checkbook's not where it's up, prosper. Do you realize how many areas that you prosper? It could be family and friends and all kind of things and health and things that you... God is prospering and watching over His children. But you know, at the same time, He's teaching us. He's teaching us about maybe finances. Hard lesson sometime. Because I figure if He could trust me with money, He'd give me a lot of it. He didn't do it, so He can't trust me yet. Let's be honest about it. Those whom He can trust, He gives it to them. See, a lot of us don't want to own up to it. That's all right with me. It's okay. Look in Scripture. The ones that He trusted, they were prosperous. Look what they did with it. I look at many, and should be many different denominations, but I think in Adventism, I think of several right now, that they build these big windmills. You know, like $2 and $3 million it costs to these windmills, generates power. And every penny that they make from that, they give it away. And I'm thinking now, what was the last... was it 40 or 50 or 100 that he had? An awesome amount, this man. Because he said, "I don't need any more to live on, and I'm going to keep billing these things, and I'm going to give every penny that they generate to the power company, I'm going to give it into the Lord's cause." They've literally built hundreds of schools and hundreds of hospitals, educating hundreds and thousands of people around the world. And I looked at this man, I talked to him personally, and said, "Wow, awesome." And I'm thinking to myself, God can trust you. He can trust you with millions and millions and millions of dollars because He knows what you're going to do with it. And He probably knows what I might do with it. So I don't have it. Well, I'm sad to say it. I smile, but it's sad. But it must be. Or that's not the calling we follow. It's not everybody's meant to have all these different things. But maybe some of us really couldn't handle it. There's many people who cannot handle, in the Hollywood scene, life. Right? They can't, the money and the fame, it wrecks their whole life and everybody else's. God watches over. He knows whom He can trust. Can He trust you? Can He trust me? But the Bible said He prospered. Did you notice that? Joseph was a prosperous man. He was in the house of his master, the Egyptian, verse 3, and his master saw that the... somebody help me now. What? Now remember, we said each one of us need to be number one on our, right, to being a vessel of honor. Step number one, I need to be have a godly influence of everybody I meet. Now notice here how this, may I say pagan, may I say heathen? Is that okay? It said Egyptian, isn't that right? He didn't know the true God, did he? Don't think so. But God put him there for a reason so He could introduce him. Somebody's with me, thanks. It said, "And his master saw the Lord was with him. And the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand." Now, what kind of a witness was Joseph to this Egyptian? Was he a good one? Everything that he went to do prospered. He said, "Wow, there's a power that's with him." See, God trying to get his attention. How do I exert that influence? Let's cover that point, if nothing else, today. And there's several little steps I think is very, very important. Some of us will like them. Some of us will not. Because you know what? I don't usually like the things that cut across my grains. But it's okay if it's truth. It's okay. We need not take it personal. It was mentioned here this morning about, you know, a little disagreement on something or whatever, you know. Blah, blah, blah. You know, the true searcher for truth will not be offended. They will say, "Well, what is truth? This is what I always thought was right, but what are you saying?" And you know what they can say? "Influence me, convince me by Scripture that what you're saying is right." This is the attitude thing. And the attitude that's been with Jesus, you see, will be, number one, humble and teachable, or we'll never enter into the kingdom of God. It's So we need to pray sometime when we're all not. Not just one individual, but sometimes we're not teachable, it seems like. There's times we're not humble as we should be. But we have to learn those lessons. We must be teachable. Now notice, I'm a believer in the spirit of prophecy, as most of you know. And I read this little quote from 2 Thessalonians 2:31. Now, if someone wants to come and disagree, what I usually do, I always give scripture and then I give spirit of prophecy. So if one contradicts the other, we have to throw out not the scripture. Isn't that right? I haven't found it yet. But if we do, what we're going to throw out some other, right? We're not going to ever throw out scripture. Because, and everything that's read from some other person pinning it down must say what the Bible has said. If they're not saying what the Bible has said, then they're a false writer or false prophet. Is that true? They have to say it. No exceptions to the rule. So I freely read from this and notice there, how do I exert an influence? Notice this. Only way that I can do it, here's what she said. You need to discipline yourself. Already we're upset, aren't we? Somebody with me. When you say discipline, no one likes it. Well, we're going to go to this school. I heard their discipline. Boy, it was brutal. Well, I'm not going there. In other words, when we say that, we're saying we don't want to be corrected when we're wrong. But I understand from Scripture that the Lord chastens, or He chastises, or He disciplines those whom He loves. Isn't that beautiful? So it's okay. He sees fit. What do you think you're going through the tests and trials that you are? Why financial problems sometime? People problems sometime? Spiritual problems sometime? Everything you turn about is just went haywire. Zach and I had such a day yesterday, at least my opinion. Isn't that right? I think you spotted it, did you not? We tried and we tried. Everything we did went pieces. Now, carpenters don't like things to go to pieces. Things are supposed to fit. And everything you go to do, you have to take 2 hours to move something to get to that one thing. And the time you get there, you forgot what you moved the stuff for. Are you with me? Oh, it's ugly. It gets ugly. Everything you move and where you put it, you find it was a wrong place. And so it was like dead work all day. Well, the day before we set trusses and made it look real good, like you did a lot of, you know, whoa, we got it working up a storm. Come back the next day and you can't tell a thing it did all day long. I sensed it. Then when you find trusses that are made to fit in one place and they're supposed to be 14 feet 6 inches and they're 15, I did all I could and I couldn't shorten them. Put them in a crock pot. Put them in a shrinker. It just doesn't work. Somehow you have to work things over sometime to make things fit. Anyway, we go through these things. We go through these disappointments and all these kind of problems, but it said how to exert an influence. I think my thought was the best way I can exert an influence with Zach is to say we need to quit before I exert the wrong one. I don't know what he was thinking because he just kind of smiled and go on, but me, I wasn't smiling. So sometime it is best, is it not? Sometime it's best for the influence that you don't say and you don't do and you know when time to quit. I haven't learned it always, and I think many of you here probably haven't learned it. But the influence is important. Why? Because the Word says, first of all, it says that we have to do what? You need to discipline yourself in order that your affections and your thoughts may be brought into subjection. So if I'm going to have a godly influence on people that I meet, first of all, I'm going to have some discipline in my life. That's what it says. In order that my affections, notice that, and my thoughts may be brought into subjection. Now notice this. Take time for self-examination. Are you always getting that? I'm always getting this. It's never examine your fellow man. Take time for self-examination. Notice this. It is the privilege of every true Christian to exert an influence for good over everyone that he is associated with. Now that's an awesome statement. It says it is possible for us to exert a good influence on every person that we meet. Who can you think has done that? Has anybody here in this room done it, by the way? Let's let somebody get bold in here. Has anybody in here exerted a positive influence, everything good on everybody you've ever met? No, sad to say, no. But you know what? We have a leader, isn't that right? We have an elder brother, Jesus Christ, who did, isn't that right? Wherever he did, whatever happened in his life, he exerted a good influence, a godly influence, because he was filled with God. And so his influence was that way in all circumstances, in all situations. And I look at my life and say, how pathetic. Example's not always been good, not always what it should be. But once again, everybody can look around and say, well, y'all, that's right. Self-examination. Think how your day was yesterday. Hope it wasn't as bad as mine, but just go ahead and think about it. How you acted and interacted with others. Three words here in 3 or 4 minutes that we've got left here. Everybody's starting, oh boy. Blah, blah, blah. First word I'm going to look at again, I'm going to look at discipline. Inspiration said we have to discipline yourself. See, the world is in a mess today because we lack discipline. Think about it. We lack it. No one wants to talk about it. No one wants to deal with it. No one wants to fool with it anymore. And it doesn't take a whole lot of time. When I was at home, it was just a quick back of the hand. Somebody not with me at all. Well, we're going to call the police on you. Go ahead. Isn't that right? We sat at church. I sat in front of my mom and dad, and when I got the knuckle on the top of the head, the next time I was jerked by the nap of the neck, taken out on the church steps in front of everybody and blistered. Somebody not with me? I didn't like that because I was putting an influence on those whom I was with. 9, 10, 11, 12 years old, I was the man. Well, the man was getting the daylights beat out of him out in front of the church. I didn't have much of a following after that, but it was consistent. Why? Because I did not learn the lessons. That's why. And I say today, I'm thankful for godly parents. I'm thankful for parents who cared enough that they were willing to go out every week. That's the way it went. That's the way it went. Because I wasn't going to discipline myself. I actually thought I could sit in front of my dad and whisper to one of my brothers and he wouldn't see me. I thought, well, he couldn't hear me. But you know, the head turns a little bit and you're going, oh, you're going to get caught. I thought I could outsmart him. It never happened. Always paid. I need to discipline yourself. Discipline was when I said, be quiet. I should have been quiet. I wasn't. So discipline here is we have to train ourselves to obey God. Are you ever trained? Anybody ever been in training for anything that was worth anything? You ask people who train for certain things in life, it's pretty difficult. For something that means, even if it's an athlete or whatever, when they train, I'm saying they put body, soul, and mind into it. Everything changes, diet, everything. I mean, they're willing to sacrifice. They put it all on the line. Train to obedience, and that means systematic training. See, that's something most of us don't have: systematic training. We're sporadic. Man, I tell you, I can't wait till the first of the year. I'm going on that big diet. Boy, I'm telling you, as soon as that clock strikes 12, boy, I'm telling you. Well, that sometimes we have to pump your stomach just prior to that because you just put so much away. Is somebody still with me? Isn't that right? We're at the New Year's, we're doing all this. Oh, friend, we're fooling ourselves. We're not systematic in this thing. We're not consistent in this thing. We're not. Maybe because we don't believe in it so much. And when inspiration said we need to discipline ourselves, it means we need to come into subjection of authority. That's exactly what it means. With methods, with regulations, based on principle. That's the first word. Number two, she says we have to discipline ourselves and our affections. What do you mean our affections? The affections here meaning the act of influencing. It's an act or state of mind, of body, of our tendencies. See, we have to discipline our tendencies. Is somebody still there? Am I by myself? Everybody out to dinner? I know we're talking about obedience, and that's a horrible nightmare to have to go through, discipline. Our tendencies. See, some of us have tendencies to do things that other people wouldn't do. Is that right? And it's easy to condemn somebody else because their tendencies is this. Because that's not ours. That's why it says self-examination. Because I guarantee if I have a tendency to go this direction, you've got a tendency to go some other way. We're all in the same boat now. We're all fighting for eternal life. Isn't that right? And remember, if you were perfect, you'd already be translated maybe and gone. If you were without sin, isn't that right? We'd already be up into the kingdom of glory. If there were people without sin, Jesus would come. If there would be a people that perfectly reproduce His character, are you still with me? It says He's going to come. So evidently there's still some building to be done. See, it's always better to put our, if the boats went down, we're all in this life, little lifeboat together, we've got the same things in mind, right? We're in the same little boat together. So my affections or my tendencies, I need to train my body and my mind. That's by saying no sometime, isn't that right? And she goes on, last one is we need to control our thoughts. Think about that. Mental activity. Now sometimes we have people whose minds are running rampant. You wouldn't want to be a mind reader, would you? No. You wouldn't. Mental activity is reflection, the things that we reflect on sometime. Would you want everybody to know what you were sitting there the other day reflecting on? Would you really now? Would you like that mind just to be an open book and I walk by and say, well, Jacob, I'll be. That's a very interesting book you might want to write there, brother. See, none of us want that. But sometime we have to train or discipline our mind from the wrong channel. Self-denial. Are you still there? By deliberation, by doing it on purpose. God asks us today, we need to discipline our mind, our thoughts, and our affection. Time to examine ourselves, because what? Because I want to be a godly influence. How about you? You want to be a godly influence? If you're a godly influence today, and we'll read much more about this because there's some just beautiful things that are written about the godly influence. If you have that godly influence today, there will be fruits of the Spirit. Are you still there? Your fruits, as you say, I'm a Christian, to be Christ-like, will produce what? Fruits. In other words, people who know you, even if you've never said, they need to know that you are a Christian. If they've never spoken to you and just see you at the workplace, they need to know that they can tell that you're a Christian. They can tell that you're different by the conversation, by what you laugh at, by what you're involved with, by the friends that you're around. And by the way, that's at school too for our younger ones. Influence is heavy out there, dear friends. Don't get drunk on the wrong influence. And God will help us. As we see, number one, our first step is I need to have, to be a vessel of honor, a godly influence. And you know what? You need to have a godly influence. And I realize mine falls short many times. But you know, I don't mind say that up front, but probably very few, maybe some of you would get up front and say the same thing sometime. That's not a sign of weakness at all. It's a sign of reality. It's a sign that we all sinners, saved by grace, that God's not done with this vessel yet. And there's hope for me. And there's hope for you. That's the good news today. I want to be a vessel of honor. And that little song that says, He's still working on me. You agree with that this morning? Won't you just kneel with me as we close with prayer? May God bless us this week that we can have that godly influence. Heavenly Father, thank you for your love today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for reminding us that you're coming after a people who represent you fully and completely in all that they say and all that they do. And as each one of us here, I pray today, does a little self-examination, that we've fallen short in so many ways, but we're so thankful that your grace is sufficient, that your blood is purifying enough that it can cover and to cleanse us as we come to you asking for the forgiveness. And you can make us white as snow. By beholding, we do become changed. Help us not to be influenced by the world and the things that are going on in the world, but just take note of those things that we may see the nearness of your soon coming. And that we might prepare now. And by preparing is simply stay close to you, Bible study, prayer, witness. Thank you for your love and every precious soul that's here today. And if we remember nothing else, I pray that Holy Spirit will help each person today to say, my influence is important. I represent Jesus. In his name we pray and for his sake. Amen.